Welcome back to the YouTube channel of Zoological Society of Assam. Today's presentation is on Physiologic Anatomy of the Kidney, Structure of Human Kidneys and its Functional Unit, the Nephron. So, the objective of this presentation is to address the following learning outcomes. What are kidneys? List of functions performed by the kidneys, structure of the kidney, structure of the nephron, the juxtaglomerular apparatus, the arrangement of nephrons in the kidney, the vasa recta of the kidney, types of nephrons, and finally, the difference between cortical and juxtamedullary nephrons will be discussed. So before we begin, renal physiology is the study of kidney function and physiology, and the kidneys are the major organs of excretion in vertebrates. A pair of kidneys, a pair of ureters, the urinary bladder and a urethra make up the urinary system of mammals and for human beings. So nephrons are the structural and functional unit of the kidneys, and each human kidney has approximately 1 million nephrons. The function of kidneys is to filter the plasma of the blood to produce urine, and this allows the kidneys to excrete metabolic wastes produced in the body. The functions performed by kidney are numerous. These are maintenance of acid-base balance, regulation of fluid balance, regulation of sodium, potassium and other electrolytes, clearance of toxins, absorption of glucose, amino acids and other small molecules from the filtrate back into the blood, regulation of blood pressure, production of various hormones such as erythropoietin and activation of vitamin D. So let us go into the detail of the structure of human kidneys. So here you can see the figure of the human renal system showing position of the different components. And kidneys in human beings, they are dark red, beam shaped, that is concave or convex organs, which are about 11 cm long, 5 cm wide and 3 cm thick, each weighing about 150 grams in an adult human male and about 135 grams in an adult human female. The location of the kidneys are the back wall of the abdominal cavity, just below the diaphragm. And they are present one on either side, opposite the last thoracic and first three lumbar vertebrae. And the lower two pairs of ribs protect the kidneys. Here you can see the components of the human renal system, where the kidneys are shown. And here these are the adrenal glands or the suprarenal glands, which are present above the kidneys. And here the renal artery coming into the kidneys and the renal vein going out of the kidneys can be seen. This is the pelvis portion of the kidney and this is the dorsal aorta. These are the ureters coming out of the kidneys, and they join to a urinary bladder which leads into the urethra. So kidneys are retroperitoneal, that is covered by peritoneum on the front or the ventral side. The left kidney position is slightly at a higher level than the right kidney. Here this is the left kidney and this is the right kidney. Here the position of the kidney is slightly above the right kidney because in the right side there is the right liver lobe. The center of the concave inner surface is called hilum, which leads to a ureter. So this center of the inner concave surface leads to the ureter. And from the hilus surface, the renal artery enters into the kidney along with the renal nerves, and the renal vein comes out. So here we can see the renal vein, renal artery going into the kidney at the hilus region of the kidney, and the renal veins coming out. This figure is a sectional kidney showing the internal structure. The origin of kidney is the mesoderm layer of the embryo. So, the origin of kidneys is the mesoderm germ layer of embryo, and particularly from a special part of the mesoderm which is called nephrotome. Kidneys are metanephric in mammals, and it can be divided into two parts anatomically, the outer cortex and the inner medulla. So in this figure, we can see the section kidney showing the internal structure. Here, the outer part of the kidney is the cortex and the inner part is the medulla. In the medulla portion, there are renal pyramids or medullary pyramids. So medulla portion is divided into 10 to 12 conical masses, which are called the renal pyramids. And renal pyramids, they have a broad base towards the cortex and a narrow end towards the medulla. These narrow ends are called renal papilla, and this renal papilla, they extend into the pelvis. This figure is also the internal structure of the kidney. So here we can see the renal columns of Bertini. Renal columns of Bertini are the spaces in between the renal pyramids. So between the pyramids, the cortex extends into the medulla or renal columns of Bertini. And in the kidney, we have major calyx and minor calyx. So each renal papilla projects into the cavity of a minor calyx. So this is the minor calyx, which leads into the major calyx. And the major calyx open into a wide funnel-like structure, which is called the pelvis. And this pelvis leads into the ureter. So this is the minor calyx leading to the major calyx, and the major calyx leading into the pelvis, which ultimately lead to the ureter. And these are the columns, renal columns of Bertini in between the medullary pyramids. So structure of the nephron. Nephron, they are the functional unit of the kidneys. And in this figure, we can see the position of nephrons in the human kidney. So this portion is enlarged to show the nephrons. So nephrons, they have two parts. A Malpighian body and a tibial part. So histologically, kidney consists of many thin, long, convoluted tubular units, which are called uriniferous tubule or nephrons. And nephrons can be defined as the structural and functional unit of the kidneys. Each human kidney may contain about 1 million nephrons. And nephrons is made up of two parts, Malpighian body and a tibule. So this is the figure of a Malpighian body of the nephron, which contains the Malpighian corpuscle or the Malpighian body, which is again made up of two parts, the Bowman's capsule, which is a cup-like structure, and the glomerulus. This is the just a portion of the tibule. Here in the glomerulus, the efferent arteriole and the efferent arteriole or the efferent vessel can be seen. This is a structure of the tibule of the nephron, where the different parts like the proximal convoluted tibule, the loop of Henle, the distal convoluted tibule, and the collecting duct can be seen. So let us see what is Malpighian body. The other name of Malpighian body is Malpighian corpuscle or renal corpuscle. So proximal end of each nephron forms an enlarged double-walled cup-like structure, which is called Bowman's capsule. And this Bowman's capsule, it is present in the cortex portion of the kidney. The outer wall of the Bowman's capsule consists of unspecialized squamous epithelium or flattened cells. An English physiologist and histologist, William Bowman, gave this term Bowman's capsule. Each Bowman's capsule contains a network of blood capillaries, which is called the glomerulus. And this glomerulus receives blood through the efferent arteriole, while the blood comes out through the efferent arteriole. Here, a point to be noted is that the diameter of the efferent arteriole is comparatively lesser than the efferent arteriole. This is the glomerulus or the Malpighian body. Glomerulus, we already discussed that it is a network or tuft of up to 50 parallel branching capillaries, which are covered by endothelium, basement membrane, and the epithelium. So the endothelial cells are interconnected with specialized renal visceral epithelial cells, which are called podocytes, and also with mesangial cells. So podocytes, they have slit pores that restrict the passage of colloids. However, small molecules and water can easily pass through them into the proximal convoluted tubule. So this is the glomerulus, which is a tuft of capillaries containing the endothelium, basement membrane and the epithelium. So this is the Bowman's capsule, and this is the efferent arteriole that brings the blood into the glomerulus, and these are the efferent arteriole that takes away the blood. The Bowman's capsule and glomerulus together receive about 20 to 25% of the cardiac output at rest, and together we can call the Bowman's capsule and the glomerulus as the Malfigian body. And this Malfigian body name is after an Italian microscopist, Marcello Malfigi. Now let us see the tubule portion of the kidney. So the tubule portion of the kidney is divided into three parts: the proximal convoluted tubule, the Henle's loop, and the distal convoluted tubule. So the Bowman's capsule opens into a proximal convoluted tubule. So this is a convoluted tube-like structure, which is the first part of the tubule. This is the anterior part of the proximal convoluted tubule, which is more coiled, whereas the posterior part is almost straight. So this is the posterior part, which is quite straight, while the anterior part is coiled. The proximal convoluted tubule is made up of simple columnar epithelium, and the proximal convoluted tubule opens into the loop of Henle. The loop of Henle, or the Henle's loop, it is a U-shaped structure which has a distinct descending limb. So this is the descending limb, and an ascending limb. So this is the descending limb of loop of Henle, and this is the ascending limb of loop of Henle. So the ascending limb of loop of Henle leads to the distal convoluted tubule. The descending limb of loop of Henle is very thin. So this is very thin, and it is composed of squamous epithelium, and the ascending limb is lined by cuboidal epithelium. So here, this is the distal convoluted tubule of the nephron. The distal convoluted tubule is a coiled structure, and many distal convoluted tubule open into the collecting duct. Distal convoluted tubule is made up of cuboidal epithelium, which is glandular in nature. And the collecting ducts of one pyramid unit form a duct of Bellini. The duct of Bellini leads into the pelvis part, and the collecting ducts are lined by cuboidal and columnar epithelium in different regions. At intervals, the cuboidal cells may be ciliated also. So here you can see the figure of ciliated columnar epithelium, and the distal convoluted tubule, or the collecting ducts, are lined by these ciliated cuboidal or columnar epithelial cells. Now, what is the juxtaglomerular apparatus? It is a specialized structure which is formed by the distal convoluted tubule and the glomerular efferent arteriole. The juxtaglomerular apparatus, or JGA in short, it is composed of the macula densa, the juxtaglomerular cells or granular cells that secrete renin, and the extraglomerular mesangial cells. So juxtaglomerular cells, which are also called JG cells, these are specialized smooth muscle cells, and these are located in the efferent arteriole. The macula densa are a set of columnar cells which are present in the adjacent segment of distal convoluted tubule. And JG cells, juxtaglomerular cells and macula densa, together they can sense the change in blood pressure and sodium concentration. So this is the figure of a juxtaglomerular apparatus showing the JG cells. So these are the granular juxtaglomerular cells, the macula densa, which are smooth muscle cells in the distal convoluted tubule, and these are the mesangial cells. So this is a figure of the juxtaglomerular apparatus. Now let us see how nephrons are arranged in the kidney. So Malpighian body and part of the proximal convoluted tubule and distal convoluted tubule are situated in the cortex portion of the kidney, and most part of the proximal convoluted tubule and distal convoluted tubule, Henle's loop and the collecting ducts are present in the medulla portion. So this is the cortical portion where Malpighian body and part of DCT and PCT will be present, while most part of the PCT, DCT, Henle's loop and collecting ducts will be present in the medulla portion of the kidney. Now vasa recta is a series of blood vessels that enter the medulla as straight arterioles and leave the medulla to ascend to the cortex as the straight venules. So here this is the figure of a nephron tubule surrounded by peritubular capillaries and the vasa recta. So peritubular capillaries surround the cortical parts of the proximal and distal convoluted tubules, while the vasa recta go into the medulla portion to approach the loop of Henle. So there are two types of nephrons with regard to the location. So cortical nephrons and juxtamedullary nephrons. So cortical nephrons are those which are present towards the cortex part of the kidney, while juxtamedullary nephrons are present at the junction between the cortex and the medulla. So here we can see the peritubular capillaries, the renal, the radial artery and the radial vein, the proximal straight tubule, the loop of Henle can be seen. And here this is the juxtamedullary nephron, which shows the efferent arteriole and the proximal convoluted tubule, the loop of Henle, and these are the collecting ducts. So these are the cortical collecting duct, while these are the outer medullary collecting duct and the inner medullary collecting duct. These are the outer medullary collecting duct and these are the inner medullary collecting duct. So based on position or location, nephrons can be cortical if they are present in the cortex portion, and juxtamedullary if they are present at the junction between the cortex and the medulla. So let us see the difference between cortical and juxtamedullary nephrons. So cortical nephrons constitute about 80 to 85% of the total nephrons, while these are only 15 to 20% of the total nephrons. Cortical nephrons are smaller and juxtamedullary nephrons are larger in size. The position of cortical nephrons is mainly in the renal cortex. In the juxtamedullary nephrons, the Bowman's capsule is present in the cortex near the junction between the medulla. In cortical nephrons, the Henle's loop are very short and extend only a little bit into the medulla, while in juxtamedullary nephrons, the Henle's loop are very long and extend deep into the medulla. The cortical nephrons mainly control the plasma volume when water supply is normal, while juxtamedullary nephrons control the plasma volume when water supply is short. So these are the suggested readings and references that you can consult for further understanding of the subject. And if there are any queries or doubts, you can contact me in this email address. Thank you very much for your attention.